शैल वी स्टार्ट? हाँ, 5 मिनट्स आई एम लेट, वेरी सॉरी. ಏನೇನೋ ಕಾರಣಗಳು, ಮೆನಿ ರೀಸನ್ಸ್. ಓಕೆ. ಓಂ ಗುರುರ್ಬ್ರಹ್ಮ ಗುರುರ್ವಿಷ್ಣು ಗುರುರ್ದೇವೋ ಮಹೇಶ್ವರ ಗುರುಸಾಕ್ಷಾತ್ ಪರಂ ಬ್ರಹ್ಮ ತಸ್ಮೈ ಶ್ರೀ ಗುರವೇ ನಮಃ. ಶ್ರುತಿಸ್ಮೃತಿಪುರಾಣಾನಾಂ ಆಲಯಂ ಕರುಣಾಲಯಂ ನಮಾಮಿ ಭಗವತ್ಪಾದಶಂಕರಂ ಲೋಕಶಂಕರಂ ಶಂಕರಂ ಶಂಕರಾಚಾರ್ಯಂ ಕೇಶವಂ ಬಾದರಾಯಣಂ. ಸೂತ್ರಭಾಷ್ಯಕೃತೌ ವಂದೇ ಭಗವಂತೌ ಪುನಃ ಪುನಃ. ನಮಾಮಿ ಗೌಡಪಾದಂ ಚ ಶಂಕರಂ ಶ್ರೀಸುರೇಶ್ವರಂ ಸ್ವಾಮಿನಂ ಸಚ್ಚಿದಾನಂದಮಿಂದ್ರಂ ತಂ ಜ್ಞಾನರೂಪಿಣೇ. ಓಂ ಓಂ ನಾರಾಯಣ. ಓಕೆ, ವಿಚಾರ ಅವತರಣಿಕ. ಇನ್ ದಿಸ್ ಅವತರಣಿಕ ವಿ ವರ್ ಡಿಸ್ಕಸಿಂಗ್ ಬ್ರಹ್ಮ ಅಥಾಥೋ ಬ್ರಹ್ಮ ಜಿಜ್ಞಾಸ. ಸ್ಮಾಲ್ ಪಾಯಿಂಟ್, ದ ಬ್ಯಾಕ್ಗ್ರೌಂಡ್ ವಿಚ್ ವಿ ಆಲ್ರೆಡಿ ಡಿಸ್ಕಸ್ಡ್ ಎಸ್ಟರ್ಡೇ ವಾಸ್ ದಟ್ ಉಪನಿಷದ್, ಬ್ರಹ್ಮಸೂತ್ರ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಭಾಷ್ಯ ಆರ್ ತ್ರೀ ಟಾಕಿಂಗ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಸೇಮ್ ಥಿಂಗ್. ದೇರ್ ಈಸ್ ಎ ಹಾರ್ಮೋನಿ ಬಿಟ್ವೀನ್ ದೀಸ್ ತ್ರೀ, ಬಿಟ್ವೀನ್ ಉಪನಿಷದ್, ಸೂತ್ರ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಭಾಷ್ಯ. ಸೊ ಸೂತ್ರಕಾರ ಬೇಸಿಸ್ ಹಿಸ್ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಸೂತ್ರ. ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಸೂತ್ರ ಈಸ್ ಎನ್ ಇಂಟ್ರೊಡಕ್ಷನ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಸ್ಟಾರ್ಟ್ಸ್ ದ ಟಾಪಿಕ್ ಬೋತ್. ಹಿ ಬಿಗಿನ್ಸ್ ದ, ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಸೂತ್ರ ಈಸ್ ಎ ವೆರಿ 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 ಕಂಪ್ಯಾಕ್ಟ್, ವೆರಿ ಕ್ರಿಪ್ಟಿಕ್ ಸ್ಟೇಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್, ವೆರಿ ಬ್ರೀಫೆಸ್ಟ್ ಸ್ಟೇಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಪಾಸಿಬಲ್. ಬಟ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಆ್ಯಸ್ ಬ್ರೀಫ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಇಟ್ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಬಿ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪ್ಯಾಂಡೆಡ್. ಇಟ್ ಎನ್ಕಂಪಾಸಸ್ ಲಾಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಐಡಿಯಾಸ್. 10 pages, 20 pages ಇನ್ ಒನ್ ಸ್ಮಾಲ್ ವರ್ಡ್, ಒನ್ ವರ್ಡ್ ಆರ್ ಟೂ ವರ್ಡ್ಸ್. ಎನಿವೆ, ದಟ್ ವಿಲ್ ಸಿ ಲೇಟರ್ ವೆನ್ ವಿ ಸ್ಟಡಿ ದ ಸೂತ್ರ. ಬಟ್ ಸೂತ್ರ ಈಸ್ ಬೇಸ್ಡ್ ಅಪಾನ್ ಉಪನಿಷತ್. ಇಟ್ ಓನ್ಲಿ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪ್ಲೇನ್ಸ್, ನಾಟ್ ಸಿಂಪ್ಲಿ ಕಂಪೈಲ್ಸ್. ಆ್ಯಸ್ ವಿ ಟೋಲ್ಡ್ ಆಲ್ರೆಡಿ, ಆ್ಯಸ್ ವಿವೇಕಾನಂದ ಟೋಲ್ಡ್, ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ನಾಟ್ ಸಿಂಪ್ಲಿ ಕಂಪೈಲಿಂಗ್ ದ ಐಡಿಯಾಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಉಪನಿಷತ್ಸ್, ಬಟ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪ್ಲೇನಿಂಗ್, ಹಾರ್ಮನೈಸಿಂಗ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಡೆಟರ್ಮಿನಿಂಗ್ ದೇರ್ ತಾತ್ಪರ್ಯ. ಸಿ, ದಿಸ್ ಈಸ್ ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆಂಟ್. ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪ್ಲೇನಿಂಗ್, ಹಾರ್ಮನೈಸಿಂಗ್, ಹಾರ್ಮನೈಸಿಂಗ್ ದ ವೇರಿಯಸ್ ಸ್ಟೇಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ವಿಚ್ ಅಪ್ಯಾರೆಂಟ್ಲಿ ಲುಕ್ ಟು ಬಿ ಡಿಫರೆಂಟ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಕಾಂಟ್ರಡಿಕ್ಟರಿ. ಉಪನಿಷದಿಕ್ ಸ್ಟೇಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ಸಮ್ಟೈಮ್ಸ್ ಲುಕ್ ಟು ಬಿ ಅಪ್ಯಾರೆಂಟ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಅಪ್ಯಾರೆಂಟ್ಲಿ ಕಾಂಟ್ರಡಿಕ್ಟರಿ. He does the samanvaya, harmonizes those statements and also ascertains the aim, the purport of the Upanishads. So it is a very brief, very very brief sutras, but even in that briefest words possible, he gives the sufficient explanation, everything very clear. Okay, so athato brahma jignyasa, what is the basis of these sutras? So here there are many statement, Upanishadic statements. Here Swamiji quotes to Brahma vidapnoti param, Brahma vid Brahma iva bhavati. Sayoha vai tat paramam Brahma veda Brahma iva bhavati. Brahma vid Brahma iva bhavati? No. Brahma veda Brahma iva bhavati. Vakya is like this. Brahma vidapnoti param, Sayoha vai tat paramam Brahma veda Brahma iva bhavati. Okay. So, for the sutra, these are the basis. Now, let us take the sutra meaning. Mantra meaning, in fact, we should say, but that mantra meaning we'll discuss a little later. That's why I just kept it suspended or postponed it. So, when Bhashyakara explains, again, then I'll come to the Upanishadic mantra, sutra and Bhashya all together. Now, let us see the sutra. We were discussing the sutra artha. Athato Brahma Jignyasa. Why we are discussing these three together? Because, see, remember the aim. Because these are technical, at the same time requires a lot of wisdom, lot of understanding also, of Anubhava. Adhyasa Bhashya is the Upodghata of Brahma Sutras. How does that Upodghata come? That Upodghata discusses Adhyasa is the problem of samsara. Now the question comes, How did Shankaracharya get that adhyasa is the problem? Where is the source? Where does he get adhyasa? Is an interesting thing. Where does he get? So first he takes the anubhava, and the mantra sutra is referring the anubhava. Sutra is based upon the mantra referring to anubhava. Three. Bhashyakara directly refers to anubhava. Upanishad mantras, see here, three things we can say. Upanishad mantras talk as a revelation. Revelation means something they reveal you, something they unfold, which a human being cannot know on his own by other pramanas. Pratyaksha, what cannot be known through, when we say revelation, we mean differently in an Indian way. The word English is a revelation, the word revelation is an English word, but we take it in an Indian meaning. What is Indian meaning? Apaurusheya vakyam. What cannot be understood through pratyaksha and anumana pramana? What is unfolded? What is declared? And what cannot be understood through pratyaksha and anumana pramana? That declaration is called Upanishad. That declaration is called the Shruti or Veda. So though we use the word, see here, we use a lot of, since I am speaking in English, we use English words, but many of those English words carry Indian meanings. You have to be based on Indian culture. We use Indian meaning, not that European meaning or Western meaning. In European context, revelation means God selects somebody, one prophet, and reveals whatever he wants to reveal to one person. See? So the God reveals, select one person arbitrarily and then reveals. It is not in that sense. And what he reveals may go against logic, may go against perception. Because what God reveals to a given prophet, there are many things about revelation and our apaurusheya, all these things, this is not the context, we'll discuss elsewhere. But here only this one point I say, the revelation may go against pratyaksha and anumana pramanas. Whereas our statement is a revelation, it can be shruti, it can be smriti, it can be a statement of any person. See, it can be statement of any person. Even if a person like you and me speak, if what that statement says is beyond the pratyaksha and anumana, and also doesn't contradict other shruti pramanas, then if it reveals something in your anubhava, it is a revelation. Whoever, even if stated by another person, it is a revelation. So our revelation has got a, though we use the word revelation, we give totally Indian meaning or Hindu meaning. So we have to keep this in mind, because I am forced to speak in English, then I have to use it in my Indian sense only. Otherwise, each point has to be explained. Then if avoid them, I have to use all plenty of Sanskrit words alone. Then even if I use Sanskrit word, again we have to explain, because these are technical terms many people can't understand. What I mean to say is, even if I use English words, keep the technical meaning as an Indian meaning. Don't borrow, don't impose, which we usually do, because all those English knowing people are more familiar with European ideas than Indian ideas. That is the biggest difficulty. Those who know English are more familiar unconsciously through our British education, Macaulay education system, and our media, and post-partisan intellectuals have infused our mind with European ideas. Therefore, we have to set aside those ideas and take our Indian meaning. So Indian technical meaning has to be explained. There is no way, whether you use Sanskrit word or English word. But at least in Sanskrit word, you can say, I don't know, I can explain. But in English, if I use the English word, you think that you already know it, because the word is familiar in your circle, English circle. So you don't have a doubt, nor you want to clarify it. Taking for granted that you already know that European meaning, you try to understand. That becomes the big difficulty. Therefore, I have to explain. Okay. So, this Upanishadic meaning, alone he presents it in his simple words, Sutrakara. And that sutra is explained by Bhashyakara. So here one point, Upanishad reveals. Reveals means what? It directly declares. a declaration, an announcement, a pointing out is called revelation. An announcement, a declaration, a pointing out. Upanishad directly points out. It points out the Anubhava. Then Brahma Sutras, what do the Brahma Sutras do? Brahma Sutra analyzes them with logic. What Upanishad declares as an authority. Authority means, I know it, therefore I am telling it. Supposing somebody says something, we will, suppose regarding a health and medical point, if some you and I say, when we get a doubt, we go to your doctor and verify. Once the doctor says, now nobody has any doubt, because he is the subject, he is expert in the subject, and then any other's statement is verified from the doctor. But doctor's statement, how do you verify? Verify from a non-doctor? You can't, another doctor you can verify. But anyway, he is also a doctor only. So all doctor put together is one medical science. Any non-medical person's statement is verified from the medical science. Instead of doctor, let us say medical science. But if the medical science statement, who will verify? A lawyer will verify? Who will verify? Or a mathematician or somebody, some other subject or a literature professor will verify? You can't do others. Similarly here, Shruti statement speaks on its own strength. Ravairiva Rupa Vishaya, as Bhashyakara says. Shruti is a pramana like the sun. Sun is directly revealing because it is its very nature to reveal. It is a very nature to reveal because that is the light. Upanishad directly reveals, directly declares. Brahma Sutra style is to analyze it logically. Logic means here the Anubhavanusara logic. And also a little bit Shruti, Shruti Anugrihita Tarka, Shruti Anukula Tarka. These two things alone. Shushka Tarka, dry logic, independent logic. Dry logic means independent logic cannot be accepted in Vedanta. Only Shruti Anugrihita Tarka, this we will discuss later. The nature of Tarka, different types of Tarka. Shruti Anugrihita Tarka, Shruti Anukula Tarka, and Samanya Tarka. Three types of Tarka. Shruti Anugrihita, briefly I say now, their detailed difference we'll discuss later. Shruti Anugrihita Tarka, the logic, the reason which is Anugrihita, which has been given by, offered by the Shruti. Shruti itself uses certain logic. There, when Shruti reveals, declares, the logic also is a Apaurushaya logic only. But it presents in a logic way. The style it uses as a logic, the style it uses as a logic, but it is also offered by Shruti only. Therefore, Shruti Anugrah. If a detail, don't ask me, I told you, if you touch the topic, it will take 1 hour, or even more than 1 hour. We'll discuss later. So, Shruti Anugrahita Tarka, with example and all that I discuss later. Then, Shruti Anukula Tarka. It is a Laukika Tarka, but in harmony with Shruti. Keeping the Shruti as a basis, we use a worldly logic to explain the Shruti. Therefore, this is Shruti Anukula Tarka. Shruti Anugrihita Tarka. Madalneedu. Yaradaneedu Shruti Anukula Tarka. Ika Muraneedu normal Tarka, which is an independent logic, Shushka Tarka, that we talk it differently. So when Brahma Sutra uses first two Tarkas. First two, Shruti Anugrihita Tarka, the logic, the reason which is offered by Shruti, and the logic culled from the human life, given by the human mind, but in keeping with the Shruti, without compromising, not going against Shruti, it is to explain the Shruti, not to challenge the Shruti, okay? Not to go against the Shruti. But independent logic is, it doesn't care for anybody, it goes its own way. So that is a Shushka Tarka. So okay, leave it. So these two, Brahma Sutra discusses logically what Upanishad says. What Upanishad declares on its independent authority, Brahma Sutra analyzes, explains, harmonizes, and ascertains its tatparya with the help of this logic. Then Bhashyakara uses all the three. Upanishadic style of revelation, directly declaring, Brahma Sutra style of using logic. Third one, he adds Anubhava also. Bhashyakara directly touches Anubhava, pointing out directly revelation, Anubhava, Yukti Shruti, Yukti Anubhava, in short. all the three. Bhashyakara uses all the three. And also fourth one, he shows the contrast with others. Contrast with other schools of philosophy, common man's standpoint, normal man's standpoint, disturbed man's standpoint, perverted man. Perverted means distorted, that's why I told. Pervert is generally, we're taking negative word. Not negative, but a slightly deviated, okay, let us say. A deviated man's standpoint, half understood, vaguely understood, misunderstood, narrow standpoint, given from a narrow stand, all these ideas are contrasted with. Shankara contrasts with what is understood from a narrow standpoint, what is understood vaguely, what is understood limited way, what is understood with a slight prejudice, what is understood with a deviation, what is understood with a just bare logic. All these things are represented by various ideas, various schools of philosophy other than Vedanta. So he shows the contrast between them, and also Shruti, Sutra, and Anubhava, and also fourth one is contrast with limited experiences, contrast with misunderstandings. These four you can see in Bhashya. I think see how thorough it is, Bhashyakaras. Okay, so Atha Shabda, we were discussing how Brahma Sutra explains, we told Brahma Sutras, because you should not feel that we are deviating and going elsewhere. We are not going somewhere else. We are not deviating. We are explaining. What are we explaining? See, main sutra we retain it. I mean, Upanishad Vakya. That Vakya he is explaining. Now, how sutra explains? Three words it contains. Atha, Ataha, and Brahma Jignyasa. Atha means afterwards. After what? What is going to follow? Brahma Jignyasa. Brahma Jignyasa. Self-enquiry. Enquiry into Brahman is going to begin. Enquiry into Brahman is going to begin. Begin means we are going to carry out Brahma Jignyasa, Brahma Vichara. When we do Brahma Vichara, who can do, when can he do? Who should do? Should do means can do. Who can do? One who acquired these fourfold qualities like Atha Shabda. What is, that's why the word Atha simply means afterwards. What is after what? After acquiring these qualities. What are these qualities we have already stated? Viveka, Vairagya, Samadhi, Shakka, Sampatti and Mumukshatva. Then how do you acquire Upanishads to discuss elsewhere? Because Brahma Sutra is based upon Upanishad that we have already stated. Upanishad itself, Brahma Sutras discuss Upanishadic statements and explain them, clarify them. Two things, scattered ideas are compiled. Scattered ideas are put together and contradiction is resolved, harmonized, and their vattartha in Kannada we call it means the collective meaning of all these statements as a tatparya, the collective meaning, the aimed ultimate aim of the whole, all these statements talking about the same topic, what is the ultimate meaning of all these things, that is a tatparya. All this is discussed by Brahma Sutra. Therefore in sadhana, this is the sadhana which person has to prepare. See, Vedanta requires preparation of the personality. Personality has to become sensitive. Sensitive means, you see, we started using the words most negatively. Sensitive doesn't mean oversensitivity, as some people become too touchy, too sentimental. A person is sentimental, we call him sensitive. A person easily gets hurt, who has got inferiority complex, he gets hurt with every small thing, every comment, every criticism, he gets hurt. Every comment he gets hurt. You touch that, yeah, your idea is wrong, your book is wrong, your teacher, you whom you follow, he told wrong things. You take Vivekananda, like Islam, like you take the name of Prophet Muhammad, you take the name of Quran, you take the name of Jesus, you take the name of, I mean, if you criticize an idea of Jesus or a Bible or Ambedkar or anybody, people get angry. That means this alone we call sensitivity. Generally, the word sensitivity is confined to this negative sensitivity. Sensitivity means what? I accepted certain thing. You have no right to discuss it. Even a healthy discussion, open-minded discussion also, you have no right. You should not criticize. You should not find fault with it because it is mine. I can make any claims, but you should accept it and you should not criticize. So they say this is called sensitivity. Oh, sentiment sensitivity, we call it. So the every word has been made to this thing. So this, we don't mean this sensitivity. We mean lack of, what you say, freedom from dull mind. When we use the word sensitive, we mean sahurdayata. In other words, in Sanskrit Shabda, he should be a sahurdaya. He should be an open person. He should not be a closed mind. He should not be a stubborn. He should not be insensitive. Like a tamasic mind is a dull mind, mandabuddhi. Both intellect and heart should be open. Sensitive in the sense openness. You see, a person is a sane and open-minded person, is ready to listen, ready to listen to criticism, ready to understand. So a mind requires that kind of positive men. In the positive sense, I am talking sensitivity. Not this negative sensitivity. Now, just now I listed all the negative sensitivity. Now they refuse to listen. You criticize the mind. That's all. Simply you say, oh, Vivekananda said here, but this is not acceptable. They say, why do you touch Vivekananda? There is one student here. And he told, you touch Vivekananda. You criticize Vivekananda. You should not touch Vivekananda. You can only praise. You should not touch. But we have been touching Kanada, Sankhya, Kapila, Patanjala, and every Rishi we are touching and analyzing. If it goes wrong, we are telling it. But it doesn't mean we go wrong. Even Badarayana Brahma Sutras, he criticizes Jaimini. Jaimini criticizes Badarayana. Did we feel this touchy like this? We have respect for Jaimini and Badarayana both. We respect Jaimini, we respect Badarayana. Jaimini criticizes Vyasa, Vyasa criticizes somebody else, and we listen to both with all respect. We don't lose respect for anybody. In fact, we feel it is a healthy way. No, but the modern society has developed it. Sensitivity. Ayo, I don't know what is this sensitivity. It is nothing but a perversion, nothing but a barbarism. The so-called sensitivity of modern people is nothing but barbarism. Now, it is an asuratva. They are calling asuratva is sensitivity. But the real openness, mind has to be sensitive. For that, body has to become sensitive. Why body sensitive? Body sensitivity means if you indulge in worldly pleasures and sex, if you indulge in overeating and sleeping also, yuktahara vihara. If the body also becomes so dull, so tamasika or rajasika, mind becomes restless, mind becomes what you call dull. You feel a pressure inside that you want to do something, you can't tolerate, you can't endure. So all this is a bodily insensitivity, tamasic body, which lives in overindulgence in pleasures, overeating, oversleeping or not sleeping, or continuously in a fighting spirit. Body which does overly physical work. Overly physical work also does body becomes unfit for a sensitive understanding. Okay. It should do like asanas and etc. is good, a balanced exercise. But if you overdo also, bodily level, your nervous system and hormones have become very numb and dumb. Body also has to become sattvic. Bodily sattvika. In fact, our asanas and the lifestyle which goes with yogasana, pranayama, they make your body and prana sensitive. Sensitive means pure and artha. Neither extreme. Neither extreme, it becomes a sattvic, good and ready for understanding. Then prana also should be shuddhi. Mind also should be. Mind means two. Both emotion as well as a thought. And also the individual personality. Shuddhi doesn't mean people think that antakarna shuddhi means any person who is a very sensitive, who doesn't do anything, who can't talk anything, even anything. So, oh, I may hurt him. Over lack of self-confidence, over-sensitive, yaar and noise Allah, he doesn't hurt anybody. He remains very, very gentle. They say a simple gentleman who doesn't talk he doesn't even criticize where it is required. Doesn't even point out where the mistake really is. Anybody says anything, he accepts it. They say this is called sattvika. This is not sattvika, this is murkata. Sattvika requires a healthy understanding. Admitting wrong is wrong, right is right. That is sattvikata. Where it is a wrong, accept it is a wrong. And healthy acceptance. The acceptance of mistake should not carry hatred or vengeance. If suppose somebody is wrong, You point out if Quran is wrong, if Bible is wrong, or somebody's statement, or even Hindu Shastra one point is wrong, we point out the wrong with all respect, with an understanding, with all sympathy. With a good understanding, with a sympathy, we discover, we understand the mistake. By understanding the mistake, we become wiser. And we understand the person who holds the view, we have a sympathy for the person who holds the view. And by understanding the mistake, we come out of the mistake, we have a broader vision. So that understanding the mistake makes you wiser, makes you sympathetic. So therefore, not seeing the mistake, closing your eyes, don't see the mistake as a mistake, see only positive side, they say this is sattvic. This is not sattvic, this is a perversion. I have to say this because, in fact, all this is not required. But I have to say this because what is antakarana shuddhi is not clear to people. People are too much afraid. Fear also is tamasa rajasa only. Sattvika requires boldness. Boldness doesn't mean rash and rude that you do rebel. They think nowadays every word is taken only in a negative way. In fact, many of the values we have to explain what is sattvic value. Bhagavad Gita does excellently. It starts with the 16th chapter. 16th, 17th, 18th. In all the three chapters, in fact, 14th chapter also discusses. It starts with 14, 16. In between, there is a 15th chapter. If you set aside the 15th chapter, from 14th to 18th, it discusses all these values of three levels. Each value, each quality, it discusses what is a positive, healthy quality, what is a slightly distorted, what is totally opposite quality. Totally opposite quality is tamasa, slightly deviated quality is rajasa, a healthy, balanced quality is sattva. So, modern society, modern education, using most of the words in negative sense. The positive meanings are missing. The media, the education system, people, the discussion. Oh, even social media, Facebook, everywhere the one side alone. One side alone we talk of it. Any situation, any event happens, we only discuss one side of it. A healthy, mature, high-level discussions are rare to come by. Because the people with a sattvic mind at the same time, clear thinkers, a creative thinkers are very few. Generally, they are very few. But in those days, they were given importance. Any topic, take to them. Let them discuss in a healthy way. Instead of taking the topics to them and listening to their discussions, common man, they say everybody is equal. Common man's discussion, emotional man's discussion, prejudiced man's discussion also is a discussion. They are taking it. They are bringing prejudiced people, emotional people, angry people, vengeance people of vengeance, vengeful people, and bringing them and say this, they are discussing. Any discussion is not discussion. Anybody is not capable of discussing. Discussion should be held by a healthy person. By listening to such people alone, people say that why should we listen to others? We are also capable of discussing. Everybody is equal. I am also equal. I am also educated. I also can discuss. So everybody has to speak rather than learn. This buddhi you have to give up if you want to be a Vedantin. Okay, mind has to be healthy. Emotion also should not be disturbed. Disturbed in the sense, you get attached to one person. See, Shraddha Bhakti in your Guru is good. Shraddha Bhakti in your Upanishad is good. If somebody wants to feel that Upanishad is wrong and wants to criticize, we allow him to criticize. We should not feel hurt that he is criticizing Upanishad. Similarly, if you find fault with the Bible and Quran, they should allow us. Okay, if they don't want to accept, they have a freedom. But when I want to look at it, I have a different view. Of course, if I have no deliberate intention to hurt, only the purpose is to malign, that is wrong. The purpose is, it is only motive of only to malign you, only to look down upon you, then that is unnecessary. That is intentional hurting. There is no intention to hurt. There is an intention to malign. But we want to analyze it in a healthy way. See how it is wrong and right. How much it is wrong, why it is wrong, and analyze and see. Oh, okay. If this way, I think there should be allowed. So therefore, nowadays sensitive means only stubbornly believing one thing. And don't allow anybody to touch my topic. You only praise. You should not find in a healthy way, you should not even find fault with it. So this kind of sensitivity is not useful for Vedanta. But yet, there is a positive sattvic sensitivity. A sahurdaya, Sahurdayatvam is required. A good hrudaya, a good hearted person, that is Antakarana Shuddhi, where you are ready to see both. Mistake is a mistake, right as a right. You should be bold enough to discover both. If the mistake is within me, I am ready to see and ready to give up the mistake. Oh, you are pointing out my mistake. How can I listen to your talk? People say that you are hurting me. You are hurting me. If you are so sensitive, if what you want is only arati, why do you come to a guru and listen? What you want is arati, go there and keep a sycophants and he will keep on praising you. Continuously do arati to you. If you don't want to be pointed, in fact, Vedanta is only pointing out your mistakes. What else can we do here? Adhyasa is a mistake. All our mistakes, Vedanta is only pointing out our mistakes. If you don't want your mistakes to be pointed out, and wherever you are, wherever you stand, we keep on only praising you, praising you, praising you if you want. I'm sorry, you are coming to your wrong person. You are coming to your wrong Shastra. Upanishad is not meant to praise you as a sycophant. If you want sycophants, we appreciate you. But there are other areas, go. They will praise you, they will write books on you, they will put a statue. If they will put a statue and do everyday worship you, you create a brand, a band of your followers, you will become another Prophet Muhammad and you become a follower. You will have thousands of crores of followers all over the world. You can go there if you want. But if you want to find your own mistakes and then come out of those mistakes, you should be ready. What is learning? Learning is finding out the mistakes and removing the mistakes and coming to the right point. All learning is only removing the mistakes, correcting the mistakes. Mistakes at the body level, mistakes at the behavior level, mistakes at the level thinking, mistakes of the emotion level, mistakes of the anubhava level. Everywhere, different levels, we are only correcting the mistakes and coming to the point. I say a person should be open. In fact, you must learn from Satchidananda Swamiji. And he says, if you point out my mistakes in my book, even Adhyasa Bhashya Swamiji told, or in another book he told, see, please show my mistakes. You will be doing a great favor to me, you point out my mistakes. See, do you see, can anybody come and approach you with humbly, appeal to you, please point out my mistakes, you will be only doing my favor. Huh? Can anybody do? Only a jignasu can do it. A healthy man wants to understand his mistake, wants to come out of it. Only such person can appeal to them with humbly can do that. Therefore, Vedanta requires a humble mind with a jignasa, means a creative mind, ready to learn, willing to learn. If you are too sensitive, no, don't, you should not touch that, you should not touch this, you should not. Shishya comes and puts a condition. You see, first thing is you should not criticize me. You should not criticize my views. You should not criticize my ajnana. Don't say that I am samsari. Don't say that my jivatvam is wrong. Don't say that my ajnana is wrong, my jivatvam is wrong, my samsara buddhi is wrong. Then leaving this, if you want to teach Vedanta, you can teach. You can teach Vedanta without touching my jiva buddhi, my samsara, my ajnana, my dehendriya manasu abhimana, my identification with body and mind. Okay? Without touching it, you talk. And I have got respect for my some of the gurus. I have got certain people whom I admire, whom I respect. I don't like certain people. So you might criticize the people whom I don't like, but I respect. All religions are same and my thought. You should not touch that point. You should not touch my Vivekananda. You should not point out any mistake. You can criticize Upanishads, you can criticize Rishis, anybody, but don't criticize Vivekananda. With this condition, if you want to teach, teach. Rishis are also less. You can criticize Rama, Krishna, Shankara, all avatars are less. Ramakrishna is the highest avatar. Don't criticize. You can criticize Krishna, you can criticize Rama. Call them fools. We will be very happy. We will clap you. But don't touch our Ramakrishna. We will listen. This person, why do you come to Vedanta? You go and sit in your circle and then keep on praising. If you want to learn, you come here. Okay? If you are open, if you are a jignasu, then learn. When you are not jignasu, why do you listen? Then what else? I have got a job. What else the guru, I mean in general I am talking, what else is the guru's job? To point out the mistake and help you to come out of it. If that is not done, then what is it? Is it just to praise you, do arati? people have to do hereafter only oil lamp, oil, and also one batti. So that you give every day this thing great and mangalam, mangalam, shubhamastu, mangalam, you are great and the hell would be. Therefore, mind has to be sensitive. Sensitive openness, ready to see both the sides of good and bad, both the sides of right and wrong, and learn and proceed. Learn and proceed. So this kind of a mind is called Antakarana Shuddhi. Balance between faith and also thinking, buddhi and hridaya manasu. There should be harmony between buddhi and manasu. That person is one who has got antakarana. He sincerely wants to learn, sincerely wants to grow, and he wants to be liberated. He wants moksha. If the mumukshutvam is not strong, you can develop it, and you must develop it. Then only Vedanta can be appreciated. Oh, I am not mumukshu, still I want to listen to Vedanta. Why should I waste time for you? When you are not interested, when you are not in, because Upanishad only touches your Atmaswarupam. By discovering Atmaswarupam, by understanding your Atmaswarupam, you will be liberated. If you don't want moksha, then how can I convince you that you are Brahman? Tell me. How can I explain to you that you are Brahman and you are not individual, you are not a jiva? You don't want moksha? You don't want to get rid of jivatvam? And I should explain how jiva is mithya? Hayya Rama, how can I? When you don't want, I should convince you what you don't want to learn. You don't want to learn, but I should convince you. Is it workable? Let me see whether directly Shankaracharya can come and do it, or when Vedavyasa can do it, or any other Vasishta, Yajnavalkya, or even Yamaraja who taught the Nachiketa can do it. Who can do that? Who can do that? Therefore, Mumukshutvam is the first important thing. Nanu kalutiddu Vedantigalalli, Viveka, Vairagya, all these qualities are there. If a person has Viveka, and if a person has one quality out of all these, Mumukshutvam is there. Even if he lacks Shamadama, self-control, control of the sense organ, even Shraddha, other things he may lack. Lack means he may have a less quantity, less degree. Even Viveka is not very clear. Vairagya also is a little less Vairagya. There is a little Vairagya, not much. Other qualities may be there in a smaller degree. But if he has got a good Mumukshutvam, you can teach him. All other qualities will develop on the way. But if you are not Mumukshu, impossible to teach you. I'll tell you. Impossible to teach you. If Mumukshutvam is there, if other qualities are less, doesn't matter. Vairagya you will develop. Antarmukhata you will develop. More and more understanding, sharpness, you will develop on the way. Viveka you will develop, all those things you will develop, because the teaching takes care of all that. But Mumukshutvam we can't impose on you, unless you have that Mumukshutvam. Because no teaching can develop a Mumukshutvam unless you yourself have it in you. This is one point I say. This is one point taken for granted. If Shishya or a Shrota has a Mumukshutvam, other qualities we can develop. Vairagyam we can develop by analyzing, by explaining. Viveka we can develop, Shamadamadi we can help you to understand, Shraddha we can develop, but Mumukshutvam, if you yourself don't have, very difficult to do anything. If you have that Mumukshutvam, other things Guru can help you. Okay, therefore, out of these qualities, Mumukshutvam is more important. That I want to be liberated from the samsara, from the jiva bhava, from the sukha, dukkha, nama, rupa, kartrutva, bhoktrutva, pramatrutva, all this punarjanma and all that. Okay. So atha shabda means sadhana chatushtaya sampatyanantaram. Iga next ataha. Because this atha shabda, sadhana chatushtaya is important. We have to say again and again and again and again, because repeatedly if you don't take sadhanas, people's mind becomes numb. They become either too much interested in intellectual ideas, and the inner antarmukhata, self-observation becomes numb. Adagabharam. We shouldn't allow that self-observation, atma-vichara, antarmukhata should not become numb. Neither we should create hatred, nor we should create hatred, nor we should create ego also. See, Shastra, Sampradaya, Guru Bhakti, Heltivi. Sometimes that also becomes a little over that it doesn't allow you to do atma-vichara. See, your Sampradaya Bhakti, your Guru Bhakti is a healthy mind. Your Sampradaya Bhakti, Guru Bhakti is to create a healthy mind. But sometimes that becomes a little over. इट बिकम्स सो मच ओवर दैट यू गेट हर्ट एंड अगेन यू बिकम अभिमानी. दैट अभिमान बिकम्स अ नेगेटिव पॉइंट एंड डजेंट अलव यू टू आत्मविचार, डजेंट अलव यू टू डू सेल्फ सेल्फ इंट्रोस्पेक्शन, सेल्फ ऑब्जर्वेशन, आत्म आत्म विचार, आत्मावलोकन. इफ इट डजेंट अलव यू देन दैट इज ऑल्सो ऑब्स्टेकल. ओके, दैट इज ऑल्सो ऑब्स्टेकल. देर शुड बी ए हेल्दी भक्ति, गुरु भक्ति, ईश्वर भक्ति, शास्त्र भक्ति, सदाचार संप्रदाय. दे शुड बी ए हेल्दी, हेल्दी इन द सेंस इट शुड नॉट बिकम एन ऑब्स्टेकल इन युवर तत्व विचार. ओके, इन इन सगुणोपासना, जस्ट कॉन्ट्रास्टिंग, आई डोंट वॉन्ट टू, माई पर्पज इज नॉट टू शो दम इन पुअर लाइट, जस्ट टू कॉन्ट्रास्ट आई एम टेलिंग यू, जस्ट शो द कॉन्ट्रास्ट सो दट यू कैन, वी कैन अंडरस्टैंड इट. सो सगुण भक्ति ऑल्सो इट इज अवर्स ओनली, वी आर नॉट टेलिंग इट इज देयर्स, देयर फॉर वी आर क्रिटिसाइजिंग. इन सगुण भक्ति इन युवर इष्ट देवता यू वॉन्ट टू रीच वैकुंठ कैलास आर ब्रह्मलोक. इन शॉर्ट उपनिषदिक लैंग्वेज इज ब्रह्मलोक, इट इंक्लूड्स बोथ. ఉపనిషదిక్ వర్డ్స్ బ్రహ్మలోక, కామన్ టర్మ్ ఫర్ వైకుంఠ కైలాస ఆర్ ఆర్ దేవీలోక ఆర్ ఎనీథింగ్. సో ఇఫ్ యు వాంట్ టు హ్యావ్ ఎ పర్టిక్యులర్ ఇష్ట దేవత సగుణ బ్రహ్మ, దెన్ యూ హ్యావ్ టు బీ కన్సిస్టెంట్లీ ఇన్ దట్ ఫామ్ అలోన్, దట్ క్వాలిటీ, దట్ రూప అలోన్. దెన్ అట్ ద దెన్ యాజ్ ఎ రిజల్ట్ ఆఫ్ యువర్ ఉపాసన, యువర్ భక్తి, యువర్ మైండ్ షుడ్ బి ఇన్ఫ్యూజ్డ్ విత్ దట్ భావన అలోన్. సమ్ టైమ్స్ దే డూ లిటిల్ ఓవర్ ఆల్సో, ఎ స్మాల్ డిగ్రీ ఆఫ్ లిటిల్ ఓవర్ డూయింగ్ ఆల్సో దే డూ ఇట్. Little bit of overdoing of your saguna ishta devata bhakti, vishnu bhakti, shiva bhakti, doesn't interfere in your vaikuntha prapti. This you remember. For vaikuntha prapti you require a humble, but even in that bhakti you become little bit of jaya vijaya in vaikuntha. You must have heard in bhagavata jaya vijayas after going to vaikuntha, they interfered in they came in the way of sanakadi. Sanakadi went to Vaikuntha. They went there to, in order to have darshan of Vishnu. So at the last gate, seventh gate, Jaya Vijaya obstructed them, prevented them. They told, no, you can't enter. God Vishnu is resting. Ishwara Bhagavan Vishnu is resting. You can't. Sanakadi told, what is this? You are coming in between God and me? Who can come in between God and Bhakta? Bhakta is the most intimate person. God also loves, Ishwara also, Paramatma also loves his Bhakta so much that he doesn't like the interference of another Bhakta. Another Bhakta can facilitate. Another Bhakta can facilitate one Bhakta, but should not interfere. Like in other religions, like desert religion, Jerusalem religions. The prophets will come and interfere. So their interfere coming is like Jaya Vijayas. They can facilitate, but they can't interfere. Because Jaya Vijaya has developed, there is a bhakti. That bhakti has become little over. It has tended into little abhimana also. Bhakti is there. The bhakti has become slightly entered into abhimana stage. Similarly, in Vaikuntha Prapti, Kailasa Prapti, little exclusive bhakti is okay. In fact, that is not required, but being a human weakness, if you have a little over bhakti, over in the sense prejudiced, start hating other and have this thing, doesn't matter, you can have Vaikuntha. In spite of that, you can have Vaikuntha. Supposing you are a Vishnu bhakta, you may have a little hatred for Shiva. If that hatred is also too much, then it again becomes obstruction even for Vaikuntha. But a little bit of hatred for Shiva is possible. Then if you have a Shiva Bhakti, a little bit of Vishnu Kadaganisuvadu is okay. Because that Saguna Bhakti is a small element of your ego. Small ego is of Bhakti ego, not of ordinary ego. Normal Bhakti ego, Bhakti ego. A little bit of Bhakti ego, a little bit of prejudice towards your own Ishta Devata doesn't interfere. They don't recommend, see, the sadhaka, the shastra doesn't recommend that this is great. But when you do it, after all, being human weakness, a little bit you do overdo it. Like Lakshmana. See, Lakshmana's bhakti for Ramachandra is so much that he gets angry when Kaikeyi asks, for example, I am giving you a concrete example. Then in contrast, you can understand, see, I have not forgotten the topic, main essential topic. Lakshmana has bhakti for Ramachandra so much that ही लेफ्ट हिज वाइफ उर्मिला एंड वेंट अवे विथ रामचंद्र फॉर 14 ईयर्स सी वाट ए भक्ति लाइक सन्यासी भक्ति एंड देन बिकॉज ऑफ हिज भक्ति फॉर रामचंद्र वेन कैकेयी आस्क्स रामचंद्र टू गो अवे टू फॉरेस्ट लक्ष्मण डजंट से एनीथिंग इन फ्रंट ऑफ दशरथ इन फ्रंट ऑफ कैकेयी बट एज ही कम्स आउट ही गेट्स एंग्री इन दैट द एंगर कम्स आउट इन फ्रंट ऑफ कौसल्या वेन इन फ्रंट ऑफ कौसल्या वेन कौसल्या सेज दट नो यू शुड नॉट गो देन लक्ष्मण इमीडिएटली सेज ममापि न रोचते इवन आई टू डोंट लाइक अम्मा राघवा इज एक्सेप्टिंग कैकेयीस वर्ड्स इवन आई टू डोंट लाइक इट ममापि न रोचते इवन आई टू डोंट लाइक इट देन ही स्टार्ट्स गेटिंग एंग्री निही सेज दट दशरथ इज अ फूल एंड आई अरेस्ट हिम आई किल हिम यू विल डू ऑल दैट सो हिज भक्ति इन रामचंद्र इज गुड बट दट भक्ति हैज बिकम लिटिल ओवर लाइक जय विजय भक्ति बट दिस भक्ति इज परमिटेड फॉर सगुण भक्ति वैकुंठ प्राप्ति दिस लक्ष्मण भक्ति भक्ति इज सो मच दट ही स्टार्ट्स किलिंग दशरथ ही सेज आई विल किल दशरथ देन रामचंद्र अलोन हैज टू रेस्ट्रेन ए लक्ष्मण बाय मुच्चो लक्ष्मण बाय मुच्चो डोंट टॉक बाय मुच्चो इज अ वर्ड टू आस्क यू टू शट अप योर माउथ ए डोंट डू दैट माउथ मीन्स डोंट अलाउ दैट काइंड ऑफ थिंकिंग भक्ति रामचंद्र सेस भक्ति इन मी युअर भक्ति फॉर मी आई अंडरस्टैंड बट दैट शुड नॉट बिकम लिटिल ओवर इन द प्रिटेक्स्ट ऑफ माई भक्ति डोंट स्टार्ट डिसरेस्पेक्टिंग द एल्डरली पीपल लाइक दशरथ एंड कैकेयी दे आर फादर एंड मदर सी दिस इन दट सगुण भक्ति ए लिटिल बिट गोस दिस वे दैट वे दे रेस्ट्रेन बट इट कैन नॉट बी रिमूव Some people retain little bit, but okay, it is like a little bit of in great people a few mistakes we allow. Great people few mistakes we allow as long as he is a qualified and right person. Like Prime Minister does many good things, but even if sometimes he may take one or two wrong decisions, people say it's a wrong decision, but it's okay after all human weaknesses. But still he has done a great man, therefore we'll give him award. Bharat Ratna award we give him. But Bharat Ratna did the mistake, do what can we do? He does little mistakes. So therefore, because individuality is retained, therefore in Saguna Bhakti, Bhakti is a sattvika, is a good and selfless. But even in the selflessness, there may be, it is not that necessary you retain in order to go to Vaikuntha, we don't say that. It is not necessary, but it is a concessionally allowed. Make note of it. All people who have gone to Vaikuntha are egoistic, I don't mean it. And that's a wrong also, nobody says that. But a little element, even if you have, it is a concessionally accepted. Generally, it is not advised, but if you have a little bit allowed. Therefore, a little bit of over bhakti is permitted. Now coming to the contrast. My purpose is not to demean them, only to show the contrast. A little bit of over bhakti is okay. First, Vaikuntha Prapti, Kailasa Prapti, or Brahmaloka Prapti. There it doesn't, it is permitted with a concessionally. But in Vedanta Vichara, if you have a little prejudice for one side, Tattva becomes obstructed. Tattva should be totally impartial. All are one. There you should be neither me nor you. Neither me, there should be overemphasis me, nor overemphasis of you. Whole thing is one truth. There should be really impartiality. There should be bhakti. There should be a very, very tender heart. Very loving heart. But that loving heart, supposing I love Vishnu, I have a very tender heart. I have a very, very loving heart. I have a sentiment for Vishnu. Even the very name of Rama melts my heart. But doesn't mean I should start hurting others' feeling. If supposing somebody criticizes Rama, what do you do? I don't hurt him. I'll just swallow the hurt. I just swallow the hurt. I don't think of hurting him. That means I try to develop my bhakti for Rama more. Even if he criticizes Rama, I will purify for my bhakti for Rama so much that his criticism of Rama doesn't interfere, doesn't pollute my. Generally, why do you get hurt? Have you understood the psychology? Supposing I love something. If somebody criticizes my bhakti for Rama, naturally I was a Rama bhakta, even now I am, I like Ramayana, Therefore, if somebody criticizes my Rama, how do you feel? Sita, particularly, if somebody criticizes Sita, what do you feel? Sita and Rama. He says, you feel hurt. Feeling hurt means what? Your bhakti gets interfered, what you call, gets polluted. Because you feel, when you have a bhakti for, when you have a love for your person, your Ishta Devata, somebody's criticism, somebody's hatred, even you come to hear, you feel that your bhakti gets shaken. Your bhakti gets shaken and disturbed. If you are shaken, you feel hurt. Feeling hurt means what? Your bhakti gets shaken. Now, if somebody criticizes my Rama, Rama means your Ishta Devata, what will you do? Rama, Shiva, or anybody. So, if somebody criticizes me, hates my Rama, my bhakti, what is the solution? I should have my greater pure heart. I should develop my heart much purer, that even if I hear open criticism, I should see that my Rama is forgiving him. My Rama is forgiving him. Rama forgives him and retains my bhakti for him. Rama blesses two ways. He forgives in the sense, he doesn't allow that fellow's criticism to hurt me, disturb my bhakti. My bhakti remains the same in spite of his criticism. Like Prahallada, openly he criticized Vishnu. In the name of Vishnu, you take the Vishnu, this is the fate you will get it. You take the Vishnu's name, Narayana, again I'll hurt you. Each time you take Narayana, I'll hurt you. Prahallada remained the same. He is abusing Narayana. He doesn't feel hurt. So you develop your bhakti more and more and more in such a way that somebody's hatred for your Vishnu, Vishnu means your Ishta Devata. Somebody's hatred for Vishnu doesn't pollute my bhakti, doesn't reduce my bhakti, doesn't shake my heart. This is the ideal. But if you have a little bit of disturbance, is also okay. Concessionally, if you develop. So in the process, they develop a little ego of my Rama. A little bit of concessional bhakti is permitted. But whereas for Vedanta, that concession is not there. If you have a concession, Svata Siddham Brahma, even Saguna Brahma also is a standpoint. Absolute is not a standpoint. It includes all good and bad and you and me and everything. Therefore, in the absolute, there should be no compromise. Therefore, Antakarana Shuddhi for Saguna Upasana, one Antakarana Shuddhi. But there a little bit of a soft corner for Ishta Devata is permitted. But an extra soft corner makes you little prejudiced. In a holy way prejudiced. It is a holy prejudice we call them. It is not a petty prejudice, a cheap prejudice Allah. It is little a sattvic prejudice like Jaya Vijaya's prejudice. They are in fact, they have no disrespect for what you call Sanat Kumara. But their bhakti for Vishnu has come in such a way that is interfering like Lakshmana's behavior. Lakshmana doesn't mean to disrespect Dasharatha, but Rama's bhakti is looking like a negative. See, his bhakti for Rama is such that he is criticizing Dasharatha and Kaikeyi. That should not be there. Therefore, you need a very impartial mind, very, very impartial mind, very clean mind. So that is Atha. Okay. Atha Shabda we have concluded. Yesterday we discussed, today also. Because I am reinterpreting it to the modern man, how to understand. Bhakti is good. But to protect your bhakti, make it so good that even somebody's hatred, somebody's criticism also doesn't hurt you, doesn't disturb you. In fact, that should be the real spirit. But we have created such a society because of only these religions alone. These desert religions and Jerusalem religions. They don't develop, they don't deepen their bhakti. They only, my bhakti, once you say it is enough. Now they want to expand socially. They want to control politically, media, intellectually. No books should be written. Nobody should say anything. They want to control others' mind rather than purifying their mind. See, they don't want to purify their mind. Therefore, their bhakti is only a pretext to control the society. Control the cultures, control the nations, control the other people, rather than deepening their bhakti. That means it is external expansion, political expansion in the name of bhakti. Bhakti is only a name, it is only a political ideology. Okay. See the difference between political expansion and inner devotion. Deepen your mind. Deepen your purity. Deepen your bhakti. So instead of that, they do this. Hindus do these things. They say, even if you criticize us, okay, take it as a sadhana for me. Take it as a tapas challenge for my bhakti. Let me make my bhakti more purer. Okay. So this way, Hindus do it in this way. Anyway, we will not discuss more into it. Ultimately, Antakarana Shuddhi means it should be simply open, simply gentle, simply unprejudiced. Even your bhakti also should not come. Bhakti should facilitate, but should not interfere in knowing the fact. Ah, okay, then Ataha. Ataha means the meaning of the Ataha we will say tomorrow. And also Brahma Jignasa, the Jignasa point is most important. That's where Adhyasa comes. We'll discuss tomorrow. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. हरि ओम श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः हरि ओम तत्सत्